5 misconceptions about sports cars. If you love cars and automotive content, make sure to like this video and subscribe. It really helps support this channel and lets me keep doing what I do. Anyways, onto the video. The first misconception is that sports cars are hard to get into and that entering and leaving them is the most uncomfortable thing ever. I've actually heard people have this as their sole reason for not wanting to buy a sports car. Even funnier is I usually hear this from people who aren't even that tall nor are very old. Let's talk about human anatomy. Humans are made to bend like this. Not bend like that. However, people always enter cars like this, and you're probably wondering, well, how come I don't feel any pain then doing that usually? That's because in a normal sedan, an SUV, or a truck, you can get away putting your foot first in and then bending like that just a little bit and then just tucking your head underneath the roof and getting in your car. For sports cars, the roof is much, much lower, so you have to bend significantly more, which then, like I said, usually pulls muscles even for younger kids who aren't even that tall. I've had friends who are 5'10" and are 27 years old who complain about my car is the worst thing in the world and they wonder how I live with it. Here is one very simple trick that will change your entire world. My friend who is 6'5", his name is Flanagan, he used to drive an NA Miata daily, by the way, and he fit in it just fine because of this one simple tactic. Enter a car with your butt first. Your butt goes in. The human body loves to bend this way. Once his butt goes in and he bends his body this way, his head can clear his roof and then he swivels his feet in. Almost every car enthusiast I know who's really tall, who owns a short vehicle, does this. I'm not even that tall, and I still do this for my own Corvette because it's just far more natural. It doesn't take any extra time either. Some of you are probably like, that looks like such an unnatural way to enter a vehicle. What a waste of time. If you get good enough at it, you can enter and exit a vehicle just as fast as someone who does normally. I have 70-year-old boomers in my Corvette club who I adore dearly, but keep this in mind, they are 70 years old. They have back problems, but even they do not complain about their Corvette. One of them is actually 6'3". Like I said, he's 72 now, and he sits in the Corvette just fine. So for a lot of the taller buyers out there, this is a tip to keep in mind, and it might have even just helped you. Maybe you're like, wow, I always had difficulties entering cars because of my size. I'll try that out next time, and I highly recommend it. Of course, for people who are really, really short, you don't have to use this tactic. You can get away if using the foot in first tactic for even sports cars, because you guys still don't really need to bend your back that much for your head to get into the vehicle. The second misconception about sports cars is that they're super low, they ride terrible, and they scrape everywhere. While this may have been true about sports cars 20 years ago, most modern sports cars actually ride rather nice. This is usually thanks to adjustable suspension settings like MagnaRide, AirRide, and so on and so forth. While adjustable suspension may seem super costly, funnily enough, repairing them is actually cheaper than the suspension systems that are found on luxury sedans. For example, some of you watching who have old Mercedes sedans, some of those may be coming up on their suspension repair soon, and you may be paying $4 or even $6 grand for, whereas I can replace my entire magnetic suspension system for around $2 grand. You can even get MagnaRide installed from factory on a lot of cheaper performance cars these days, and a lot of entry-level performance cars, like a Mustang GT can even be optioned with it, and it's definitely worth it. To give you an example of how much of a difference it makes, a lot of my friends who ride Honda Accords, Ford Tauruses, and other family sedans, not luxury sedans, just normal family sedans, and I put my car in touring mode, they realize just how soft it is. It is so soft, in fact, that they've even remarked that it's softer than their sedan, despite being a low-slung vehicle. Now, of course, if you talk about like an executive sedan, like the LS460 in my garage, or like a Mercedes, literally any Mercedes S-Class, those obviously are still way more comfortable than a sports car, even with MagnaRide. But again, like I said, usually they use just as expensive, if not sometimes even more expensive, suspension systems. As for scraping everywhere, a lot of sports cars are now equipped with splitters, rockers, and you can further equip them with things like slip low, which is basically just rubber guards. You can also put air suspension or hydraulic lifts, or use aforementioned magnetic suspension, which doesn't really lift a vehicle all that much, at most maybe an inch. Some systems don't even change ride height at all, but airlift is the one I really, really want to talk about because it's super popular. Air ride has been around for multiple decades. I've talked about it all the time this channel, but I still see people who don't know about it. I've actually recently went to a car meet where one of my friends, I have tons of friends who have aired out cars, but for this specific example, one of my buddies has an aired out G37, and we went up to a speed bump, and some 45-year-old redneck looked at him and just pointed and started laughing, says, "Ha, buddy, what you gonna do? Can't wait to see you scrape that expensive carbon splitter of yours, ha ha. Shouldn't have thought about that before you went that low." And then my friend just went and his car just aired up and he went over it because it lifts his car a whopping 4.5 inches, which basically makes his car ride higher than a sedan does. And he went over the gap just fine. And the look on that guy's face, like he had just witnessed alien technology, was definitely worth that interaction. Another misconception about sports cars is that they get terrible gas mileage. So most performance cars, while having slightly more horsepower compared to non-performance variants, will be better with fuel economy or have slightly lower fuel economy than their economy car variants because they still have good aerodynamics. They also weigh less because those are two attributes that are very important when tracking a vehicle or cornering with a vehicle. Therefore, companies who make sports cars prioritize those. And those two attributes also consistently increased fuel economy, which is nice. Of course, you will have something like a Lamborghini Aventador with like a 6.5 liter V12 with freaking dual overhead cam and 4 valves per cylinder. Yeah, obviously that's not going to have very good gas mileage because that is quite literally everything is high, from valve count to camshaft count to cylinder count to displacement count. And it's also an all-wheel drive system as well. So cars that are all-wheel drive consume more gas than rear-wheel drive or front-wheel drive because they're powering all 4 wheels instead of just powering a drivetrain for rear or front wheel only. Another misconception about sports cars is that low horsepower cars aren't actually true sports cars. This misconception I've actually dedicated a whole video for, but I'm gonna talk about it in this video because I know my videos that have numbers in front of them tend to perform better. So, by low horsepower cars, I'm talking about Scion FRSs, BRZs, 86s, we'll just all put them in one cat. For the sake of this video, I'll call all three of those cars the Hachi Roku platform. So whenever I say Hachi Roku, I'm referring to those three cars. The Hachi Roku is constantly teased for being a extremely slow car, and a lot of my non-car friends, whenever they hear about it, they say, oh, it's that one wannabe sports car, oh, it's that one fake sports car, it only has like 200 horsepower. And I'm like, look, I get it, your Honda Accord Turbo can pull on them at a stoplight, but you go on a mountain run with them, they are leaving you behind. Not after the third or second turn, the first turn. Those cars can even leave behind Porsche Boxsters of older generations, and that's really impressive considering how much those cars cost. They're not the only ones, obviously. Miatas get a big problem with it. Even speaking of Porsches, a Porsche Boxster itself also receives a lot of complaints, like the Caymans even do too, because people will look at something like a Sport Chrono package for a Cayman and be like, oh, it's only 5.1 seconds. I can buy a V6 Mustang and do an ECU flash tune and some exhaust. And like, sure, 0 to 60 wise you will, and you will do it for a fraction of the cost as well, but that's not all that makes a car, especially a sports car. Now, with curvy roads, having a low horsepower sports car that's really good at handling, that's where they shine. They're extremely fun, and they're also extremely fast and nimble, these circumstances. So this isn't just something that can only be enjoyed on a track. I would beg to differ. They're actually more enjoyable on the street than even a high horsepower car. One of my biggest tragedies of owning my current vehicle is that I'll go through first, and then second, and then I'm already breaking the law by like 30 miles an hour, because it'll be like a 45 zone, and I'll be going like 70. They really do be like that. One of the reasons I envy Miata or the Hachi Rokus or Porsche Caymans and other slower quote-unquote sports cars is that you can actually road through all of their gears without breaking the law. You can actually just enjoy the car at normal traffic speed. And that is a blessing that you can only understand once you've had a ridiculously fast car and you now hate how little you can actually use most of that power. The final misconception of this video is that they're wasteful to create. So again, this is also an environmentalist argument, but also just an economical argument where some people, especially board executive members, usually try to phase out sports cars because they think they're pointless. People think performance cars, due to how low their production numbers are therefore a waste of resources, and they could have therefore used those resources on more commonly produced higher production models. But here's why that's wrong. Most technology from sports cars will trickle down and find itself being used in all of the other models in the lineup. So the next thing someone's probably about to counter with is, well, why don't they just use all that brand new technology in the other cars first instead of the sports car? There's two reasons for that. First one is it's a lot harder to convince a boardroom of executives to make a new, potentially faulty and risky advancement on a higher production vehicle due to the amount of customer backlash it may receive. However, it's easier to test out experimental technology on car guys because car guys are more forgiving, and some of them are literally designed to be critics where they're usually fans of certain vehicles and they're willing to help submit feedback for it to improve. On top of that, sports cars are lower production, so you're testing out new technology that could potentially be faulty in lower numbers now, so you make less of that technology, which is cheaper from an R&D standpoint, and then you put it in less of the vehicles, which therefore protects it from being too scrutinized from the mass public, because like I said, sports car owners usually aren't as big on scrutiny, and they'll actually send positive feedback, which then helps improve that technology, which then helps it eventually become reliable enough to use that technology in normal cars. This could not have been possible by just skipping over sports cars and going to normal cars. Companies have tried this for decades, and there's a reason why companies that have sports cars still are the leaders for technology in certain areas. The second reason that people need to remember is that competition is the mother of innovation. Sports cars are the most competitive industry in the automotive segment. So if everyone made new technology on non-sports cars, there wouldn't be as much competition over it because those segments usually just naturally don't spawn as much competition. But because sports cars, I'm not gonna lie, there's definitely some ego involved, there's definitely some insecurities involved, and there's definitely a lot of dick waving involved where people like to flex their muscles a bit, especially companies. And that's actually a good thing because it benefits us consumers when those companies like to compete with each other. Think about it. Ferrari has Lamborghini, Koenigsegg has Bugatti, Ford has Chevy, Honda has Toyota. And in the racing world, their competition is even more strict. They're on track, learning the limits of their technology, destroying them, and then breaking through them by repairing it and trying to figure out why it failed, how it cannot fail. And then all of that that's learned makes it into your vehicle, even down to a Honda Civic, even down to a Honda Fit. Those have all taken technology that was once in a race car. The racetrack is a battlefield, and racing seasons are essentially wars. And as we've learned from history class in elementary school, war is the mother of invention. As terrifying and as sad as that is to say that, whenever things are extremely hyper-competitive like that, in the case of wars, unfortunately, lives are lost, but in the case of racetracks, cars are constantly broken down and destroyed, it pushes them past their limits. Ironically, they become stronger each time they break. This is why when people watch race events, they think they're wasteful, and they think sports cars shouldn't exist, because they say, you're just literally blowing it up for no reason, you're wasting it for no reason. Actually, one way or another, every car and everything and every new item in history at one point failed. Like, obviously, we've all heard stories about how before the first light bulb was created, it had thousands of failed prototypes. And there are many things in life where you learn from failures to optimize the successes. That is why sports cars need to exist. That is why race cars always need to exist. They're not wasteful to create. All the technology and all of their failures learned does enhance all the successes and find its way to all of the other vehicle lineups in the brand. Anyways, that's going to be it for this video. I hope you learned something new about cars, and I hope I cleared some misconceptions about sports cars. If you enjoy this type of content and would like to see more for it, make sure to like this video and make sure to subscribe. Other than that, thank you for watching, and see y'all next time. Bladed Angel out.